Amen. Yeah, alhamdulillah. I mean, like, if we take money from people, we should give it back to them. You know, we should not take in money from the people. It's haram. You know, we as the Muslims, remember, it's amana, it's a trust. It's a trust, amana. You be asked about it, you know. We don't want to die with the debt, you know, subhanAllah. Because on that day, the day of resurrection, we don't even have enough goodies to save us, let alone give my goodies to someone else. That's why when Hassan al-Basri, someone came to him, he said, yeah, Imam, I've heard you backbite me. He said, if I want to backbite anyone, I will backbite my mother and father, because by backbiting them, I will give them my good deeds. So if I want to give my good deeds to anyone, I will give it to my parents first, before I give it to you. You know, subhanAllah. So Allah al-Musta'an, man. You know, that's why I said to him, according to his speech, no doubt. But, you know, when it comes to judging between people, you need two people. Yeah, yeah. You have to listen to both sides. Nah, that's the advice. This general advice. You know, subhanAllah. Look to Qissat Yusuf.
What about in circumstances that you can't?
Nah?
You know, you say when you borrow from someone, you have to give it back. What about in circumstances that you can't?
Okay, if you, yeah, if you yeah. cannot give it back to them, imagine someone gave you any money, amount of money, and you try to give it back to her or to him, but you cannot. So what you do, you try your best. If you cannot, then the scholars mentioned, you give it as a charity. On her behalf or his behalf. And now, if you give it as a charity, then you meet him or meet her later on, and she said, you know, my sister, I'm not happy, I want my money back. Then you give the money back, and what you have given as a charity will be in your good deeds. Tayyib? Alhamdulillah, this is the ni'mah of Islam, you know, alhamdulillah. Because, and also I want to mention something, you know, just I don't want to mention the brother's name. A brother sent me a video of this brother speaking about a Christian, and the argument that his brother used against Christian can be used against the Muslims too. You understand? So, as we know, a Muslim, if he's a muwahid, regardless what sins he would do, they will not take him to the hellfire, except if he falls into nullifies Islam. Raping a woman is a major sin. In Islam, you receive a capital punishment, because not just adultery, you are forcing yourself. According to my knowledge, some scholars mentioned, according to my knowledge, you come under, and someone correct me if I'm wrong, you come under al-mufsiduna fil ard. Because you know, just had intercourse outside marriage or adultery, you forced the woman, yes? However, in Islam, a woman getting raped is not justification for her to reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because, or a man getting raped or whatever, you know, that's just, it's not justification for these people, this emotional argument. Because knowing Allah and worshipping Allah, every part of our body testify to that. That's why accepting Allah as our Lord and worshipping alone is something that is so clear. When the atheists try to look for any excuses to reject Allah, there is not any doubt it boils down to two. I've mentioned that many times. Two factors. Either is a psychological factor, for example, it's emotional factor. I got raped, you know, that's haram, it's forbidden Islam. Rather than Islam, we don't put them in prison and we take care of them, we treat them better than the victim. You know, Islam, they will receive severe punishment, even under Allah's threat. However, it's under Allah's will. Because on the day of judgment, there is no sin worse than rejecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have to be careful. We're not here to please a non-Muslim by saying, you know, if the brother who said it, subhanAllah, I couldn't believe it. I mean, if the Christian woman that he was speaking to, if she knew, she would flip it on him. So, but you believe if a Muslim, regardless of what sins he would do, if he dies upon Tawheed, he will go to Jannah. Yes, maybe he will be punished with a fire, but he will not be in a fire forever. He'll go to Jannah. Eventually, he'll go to Jannah. Because the greatest sin, because many people don't know the meaning of shirk. When you commit shirk, all injustice that you see is coming from there. You understand? So that's the problem. But if someone now, like Nabi alayhi salatu salam, when there was a man who killed many companions, tayyib, he killed many sahaba. And Nabi alayhi salam caught him. Not Nabi, his companions caught him. His companions caught him, yeah? And they put him in the masjid. Prophet was looking for him for a long time. He was known to, he killed many sahaba. So he came, and Prophet said, do you know who you have captured? He said, who? He said, it's a sahabi, Thumama. I forgot his name, one of the, he said to him, they said, oh, Messenger of Allah, is that him? He said, yes. Prophet said, take care of him. He became Muslim. And Nabi also mentioned on Day of Judgment, when there will be two, the murderer and the one who's been murdered, they will go to Jannah together. How? The murderer will become Muslim afterwards, and Allah forgive all the sins. And on Day of Judgment, Allah is just. Allah will give the victim satisfy him or satisfy her. You understand? So the calamities, even as some scholars mentioned, the calamities that happened to the kuffar, Sheikh Saha Sheikh mentioned that, by the way, some scholars mentioned that, he quotes, that Allah will lighten their punishment in the day of resurrection. But they're going to be in hellfire forever. So don't look for any justification to reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the greatest sin against Allah, you need to turn away from Him. Everything that exists points towards Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. That's why the atheists, if you notice, they will look for anything, either emotional argument, which goes back to psychological factor, or a social argument, which goes back to, I'm someone that my people look up to me, how can I live, how can I become a Muslim? And I believe this is the case of Bob, Paperboy. I don't know what's wrong with these names, Bob, Paperboy. It's a cartoon, man. That's what they call themselves. Paperboy and other, they know Islam is the truth. And majority of non-Muslims, they know that. They know. But Jew today, they are well respected amongst their communities. They don't want to become a Muslim. That's why Islam is so clear. When you explain to people, naturally, you gravitate towards Islam. So nothing can stop you. There's many Muslims, women being raped. Look what happened to our Muslim sisters in Syria. Wallahi, the Muslims in Syria and Palestine, you learn how to be strong in Iman from them. They've been raped in a prison. Their husband been murdered. But did they change their religion? They said they're Muslim. And what you hear from them? Alhamdulillah. Allahu Akbar. May Allah bless them. And may Allah aid our brothers and sisters around the world. You know? So this justification, don't think because you've been raped, which is evil act, no doubt about that. You know, if you go psychologically, you know, because Islam pays attention, if you become disturbed mentally, then Islam, the Prophet Muhammad said, you will not be held accountable for whatever you're going to say or you're going to do, because the pen has been lifted up, because sanity is not there. Something mentally disturbed you, you understand? And I show you justice, Islam. But if you are there, you should not utilize whatever happened to us. This Allah mentioned the Quran. Many things will happen to us in this universe which will disturb us, which is, however, Allah mentioned this life is full of tests. And Allah mentioned that, look, and Nabi said, they will bring a person all his life, just hardship, all his life. They put him into Jannah and they ask him, oh so and so, have you ever tasted any hardship? He said, never in my life. Never. You understand? And they will bring a person all his life, enjoying his life, he's a kafir billah, doing everything, he never went through hardship. They put him into Jahannam and they will say to him, oh so and so, have you ever enjoyed your life? He said, me, never. The punishment of fire, may Allah protect us from the punishment of the fire. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enter us and our parents and our loved ones into Jannah without any reckoning and without any punishment. Barakallahu feekum. So we have to be careful. We should not be using argument against the Christians for the sake to make them look bad front to the liberal and so on. But this argument can be used against you too. That's what the Christians do here in Speaker's Corner. We're not here to please people. We're here to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's nothing worse than a shirk. There's nothing worse than a kufr. Because why? Everything that exists, even your fitrah, gravitate towards you worshiping your Lord. But because you're arrogant, that's why people of Jahannam, who are they? Mutakabbirun. فَبِئْسَ مَثْوَى الْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ. What an evil destination for the evil ones. طيب. So again, no one should misquote me. Rape is an evil act. In Islam, capital punishment, we don't put them in prison. We take care of them more than the rapist. You understand? We don't. We give them food. They go to gym. They play football in prison. They watch TV 24/7. They have PlayStation. No, you'll be punished severely. And that's why I've noticed many people who hate Sharia because they are criminals. Because Sharia, even the capital punishment Islam, is good for mankind. So why you hate it? Because you are a criminal. Yeah, because you're a criminal. You hate what? You hate severe punishment. Or you are either a criminal yourself or ignorant. You don't know about Islam. So we clarify to you. You know? So Islam came, as we have mentioned, to preserve what? Five things. Life, wealth, and so on. And lineage. Barakallahu feekum. So it's just a reminder, we have to be careful. I mean, all of us, we make mistakes. All of us, sometimes we say something, maybe in a time of anger or something, may Allah forgive us all. If I made any mistake, you can correct me. Whatever I said, you can challenge me, alhamdulillah. Correct me. I'm at the end of the day, I'm a human being. You know, I make mistakes. Barakallahu feekum. Ameen wa iyyakum. So if you have any question, my advice is to learn, ikhwah. My brothers and sisters, learn your deen. Learn your deen. Study. And prepare ourselves for the akhirah, for the maut, death. Lies, so, you know, we have to prepare ourselves anytime we can live this life.
Do you think it's a bit like, you know, we have right now all these like sectors, different this, different that. Do you think that's a time of confusion for like Muslims, people trying to learn about their religion? Like, how do you go about with that?
That's true.
There's so many, like, you don't know what to do. Like.
When I start practicing, my sister, same thing happened to me. When I started practicing, there was many sects. This brother said these people are wrong. The other brother said these other people are wrong. You know, I got confused. And I was like thinking, what is going on here? But when one of the brothers told me, he said, Shamsi, look, go study, learn. That's what his advice. He's a Salafi brother. He said, go learn. He said, look, you keep going this way, that way. What I advise you, go learn. Because what I was doing, I was asking about individuals. I said, what do you think about so-and-so? He said, look, I can't tell you about many people, but the problem is now, you're going to become emotional. Because you've listened to them for a long time and you are attached to them. If I say something bad about them, you're going to try to block it. Well, I would tell you, go study. When I started learning, I came to conclusion, alhamdulillah, there's no confusion. Why? Because Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told us what is going to happen right now. So what you see, my sister, may Allah bless you, what we see in our time, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told us about it in the hadith of Irbad ibn Sariyah and the hadith of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, the hadith and the other hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, that Nabi ﷺ said, my ummah will split up into 73 sects. They will be divided into what? 73 sects. He mentioned that. So now when the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said that, the Sahaba, that's a disease, because splitting is a disease, no doubt. But that will occur and will take place in our ummah. But Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he left us upon a clear guidance. It's day like it's night, yes? So he gave us a disease. What is the cure? He said, follow my way and the way of my companions. Another narration, and Nabi, and by the way, my sister, my brother and sister here, if you notice, when the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told about the 73 sects, he said, all of them deserves to be punished with the fire, except one. He never said that one, Muslimun. He never called them Muslims. Why? Let me ask, why? They are all Muslims. Because the other sects, they are Muslims too. So if you just say Muslim, there'll be confusion. So he gave them a characteristic which is specific for them in order for all of us here to know who are following the truth. Another narration, which is of Al-Irbad ibn Sariyah, he said, "Man ya'ish minkum fa sayara ikhtilafan kathira." Whoever lives among you, you will see many, many differences. That's what we see now. Many differences, many sects, many groups, many individuals, you know, so-and-so refuting so-and-so, the other. But Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam clarified where he said, alaykum bi sunnati, where it's upon you, upon me, upon all of us. Follow the sunnah of Mustafa alayhi salam, wa sunnat al khulafa al rashideen, and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa. The sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa. Another narration, which is the Bukhari and Muslim, لا تزال طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله وهم على ذلك. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, that there will be a group of my ummah, not the whole ummah, a group of my ummah manifesting upon the truth. So why there's confusion, my sister, may Allah bless you, oh my brother, sister, here, because we don't study. But when you study, Allah will become clear to you. I was like this, I was confused. I remember I spoke to one of the brothers, that was 2005. I said, Akhi, you refute everyone. There's no one saved from your tongue. But after he said, you know what? Go study. Alhamdulillah, wallahi, reading the Quran, the Sunnah, the books of the Salaf. The books of the Salaf. Usul al-Sunnah al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani. Usul al-Sunnah al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani. Shah al-Sunnah al-Imam al-Muzani, who is a Shafi'i. Tayyib. Aqidat ibn Abi Zayd al-Qayrawani, Maliki. Tayyib. Usul al-Tiqad al-Sunnah al-Imam al-Lalika'i or al-Lalika'i. Hibat Allah. There's many books was written by the students of the student of Sahaba to clarify what is the correct path for us to follow. So what is upon us to study? And will Allah give you that knowledge, the Quran, the Sunnah, and the books of the Salaf. Many people you're listening to now, maybe you will leave them. I'm telling you. So study Allah, alhamdulillah. That's why I always emphasize when I'm here. Don't busy yourself too much with the Bible. John, Mark, Luke, Matthew. Now, you know, we lie too much about it. No, Quran, Sunnah. Even I said it many times. Too much debate become entertainment. People who's watching debate, that's just entertainment. No, we have to learn our deen, barakallahu feekum.
Just for screaming,
Ashad. Yeah, sometimes like a screaming match. And sometimes because the nature of the debate, you start screaming too. Then you go back home, you take 5 paracetamol. You know, you advocate is lying, man. So Allah al-Musta'an, may Allah forgive us all, man. But yes, is that clear, my sister?
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome, barakallahu feekum. Yeah, alhamdulillah, knowledge is very important. Al-ilm. قال علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه وأرضاه العلم خير من المال. ليش؟ لأن العلم يحميك، أما المال فأنت تحميه. علي بن أبي طالب may Allah please with him said knowledge is better than wealth. Why? Because the knowledge protects you. As for the wealth, you protect it. Now if someone come to me say let us blow up the central line because they are kuffar and they kill our Muslim brothers and sisters in Palestine or Syria, I said no, that's haram. Allah said don't kill yourself. And Allah said do not harm those who never harmed you. So I have that knowledge to protect myself from going to blow up myself in the train, claiming that it's a jihad. I said, this is not from Islam. That is a jihad in the path of Satan when you kill innocent people. You understand? But when you're ignorant, that's why majority of people that went with ISIS, they were, the night before or the day before, they're going to nightclub, they're doing music. They didn't know. That's why I want to clarify something. By the way, I do not believe every person that joined ISIS was an evil person. I believe in the beginning they were deceived. As for those who went after, was clear, when Scott spoke out and clarified, and they still went, then you know the truth, but you turned away from it. You know? But before even Britain, Europe, they were allowing people to go fight against Bashar. You understand? So I don't believe that because I remember a sister came to me, her husband died in Syria. He went with ISIS, then he found that they were evil. They were just lie. They were killing Muslims, he left them. When he about to leave them, they killed him. Because he's from a Muslim country. If you pray janazah in a Muslim country, they're going to ask you where is the paper, the certificate. So she asked us to pray on him, Salat al-Ghaib. And one brother, he told me, listen, Akhi, my cousin, he wants to leave these ISIS people. And when they found out, they were tracing him, Akhi. And I don't know why, if he died, he's still alive. Yeah, who the heck is this Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi? Out of nowhere, it's Khalifa. Khalifa of what? That's why these people, look, many extremists in Britain, who found that they were working with MI5.
Allah.
Yeah, one of them, I don't want to mention his name, by the way. They took him to America, and he said, I was working for MI5. He said to them, we don't care, we're an American now.
Shamima Begum story.
Wait, what about her?
Shamima Begum.
Yeah, what about her?
A 15-year-old.
She was the
what? She got taken to Syria and yeah. Spoon-fed by the Secret Service of Canadian Secret Service.
Barakallahu, and they accused Salafis of doing that. But this, she's a little one. I'm talking about the head of them. The head of them who was back like 10, 15 years, 20 years, who was going around accusing Salafis. They work for the non-Muslims. He himself, when he was caught up and they took him to America, he said, I was working for MI5. A'udhu billah. And that's what the robber, evil do. Evil people, what they do, they accuse innocent people to turn people, their focus from them. You know, alhamdulillah, we love our brothers and sisters in Islam. That's why if you have a family, make sure your sons, your daughters, you have to know who they are going with. If they're going, even Islamic Youth Club, you have to know which Islamic Youth Club, who's there. Because I remember 15 years ago, not 20, or lesser, I was going to one youth club. There's some ignorant ones that were teaching. Thinking, people don't even know how to pray. And he's teaching them about the story of Khalid ibn al-Walid. Alhamdulillah, Khalid ibn al-Walid was a warrior. True mujahid, not fake mujahid, killing innocent people. But people don't know how to pray. Himself doesn't know how to pray. You understand, akhi? So we have to be careful. This is my advice to the parents out there. Be careful if your son start practicing, alhamdulillah, is a ni'mah. Your daughter start practicing, alhamdulillah, is a ni'mah. But you have to know who they are hanging around with. Because these ISIS followers, they still exist. They have different names. They're like cockroaches. When you turn the light on, disappear. When you turn it off, they will come back in. So you have to kill innocent people. There's no justification to kill people in Madrid. or Paris because our brothers and sisters are oppressed in another country. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that fight those who fight us. No, fight those who are innocent. Billah alaykum. How you doing a suicide bombing in Morocco, Algeria, or Pakistan is jihad? In the non-Muslim countries, you're doing it because jihad. What about Muslim countries? Can a Muslim woman, Muslim man, even can non-Muslim innocent man or woman child, is haram? Yeah, they believe Muslims are kuffar. Sahih. Like one of them, he gave a fatwa from here. He said in Algeria in the 90s, when there was a civil war, he said that killing children, Algerian children and women is allowed. Why? Because you want to reach the targets. I've heard he took it back after, out of Amana. But after how many children were killed? Many. Many children were killed, akhi. Many women were killed because of this evil, dirty, disgusting man. Where he was in Britain. And give a fatwa. That's why when they tried to accuse us to be terrorists, we said, hang on. In the 90s, we were fighting against the terrorists when they were in your country, protected by you. Bin Laden, the Muslim scholars, won't against him in the 90s when he was working with the Western world. And you accuse us that we're terrorists. Of course, Akhi, love the head of terrorists of Algeria. They came to France. They came to Britain. 2001, I went to a mosque in Finsbury Park. I went inside the mosque. I was young. I was even practicing that time. I had to pray Jumu'ah with my friends. I said, let's go pray Jumu'ah. I saw on the wall, alhamdulillah, we have killed 10 Algerian soldiers. I said to my friend, wait, what are we doing here? What's this? Even the people look scary in there, man. I said, bro, what is going on? This is not Islam. You know, even killing innocent, my cousin died because of that. You know, subhanallah. May Allah protect the Muslim brothers and sisters from these evil ones. You know? Who's Abu Bakr Baghdadi? Who is he? I have no word. Hey, come on, man. Be aware. We believe in jihad. Of course, jihad is a noble act of worship. But jihad was legislated to remove oppression, not to bring about oppression. Jihad was legislated to defend the innocent one from the tyrant, not to kill the innocent one. Barakallahu feekum. You know, that's why jihad was legislated. And the jihad was out of necessity. I've noticed, you know, far right, they are like brothers with the extremists. Far right, they see a Muslim sister with hijab, they remove it. These extremists, they go innocent English man or woman. Alhamdulillah, we as Muslim Islam teach us be just. If someone come to rape my sister, I'm not going to go rape his sister. His sister has nothing to do with it. Why his sister has nothing to do with it? Barakallahu feekum. Look at the teacher of Islam. Barakallahu feekum. And Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam, in the war, he said, don't kill women, don't kill children, don't kill innocent people, don't kill a man in his temple. Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy upon him, said, if jihad was legislated because someone is a kafir, then the first people that we should have killed are their scholars. But Islam teaches do not kill their scholars, except if they come to fight us. Alhamdulillah. You know, and we've been fighting against the extremists, against this Khawarij from the 90s, our teachers, our scholars. Then they say, Wahhabis are terrorists. You're a liar, man. Yeah, they say, Madakhila. They say, Madakhila work for the government.
Alaykum as-salam, khoi, kibla haj. Here's my number. If you see the brother, I'll give you his name in a minute, yeah?
Khalas, after. Tayyib. Kibla haj, bikhir. Alhamdulillah. So, yeah, Allah al-musta'an, man. Just advise, be aware, alhamdulillah. Be aware. Because I was walking once in Acton. Few of these guys came to me. May Allah guide them. And I won't speak to them. You know, I'm walking the alleyway. They came, you know, there were like four of them or five of them. Or more, it's just coming out of nowhere. You know, but I spoke to them. They say you're going to invite me. I said, can we talk? I have no problem to talk with you. I want good for you. They tell me, one of them told me what happened to Hatun here is jihad. I said, there's no jihad. Hatun is an evil woman. Hatun is a disgusting woman. Is an evil liar. She wants to be a martyr. This Hatun, hyena, by the way, Okla hyena. She's a hyena. She's not a human being, it's an animal. You know? We don't even entertain her. And I believe it was a setup. I don't even believe this happened. You know, so, hey, come on, this guy, they're lying. You know, they try to get people to sympathize with them because Christianity is dying. Every Sunday in, out, they accuse the insult to Prophet Muhammad. And Allah raised the name of Muhammad. and Allah debased them. Subhanallah. The most popular name in Britain, Muhammad, Allahu Akbar. The number one, the most name, Muhammad, alayhi salatu wa salam. And Allah mentioned in the Quran, Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. That your enemy will be cut off. Wa rafa'na laka dhikrak, akhi. We have raised your name. Allah raised him, alayhi salatu wa salam. Look how many influences online becoming Muslim. They see Islam is the truth. And now, like look, in Britain, alhamdulillah, they open a way for us to teach, to give da'wah. Utilize it, be good to them. Alhamdulillah, how many people accept Islam, alhamdulillah? You understand? How on earth you go kill an MP? Like what happened last year, when the guy went and stabbed the MP. Old MP, you kill him. Is Islam, is Islamic teaching? Allah salama wal afiya. Come on, man. That's not Islamic teaching. And I don't believe every quote-unquote terrorist act happened were carried out by Muslims. I don't believe that. Some of it is a setup to make Islam look bad. Especially now, we have to be careful, my brothers and sisters. Be cautious. Islam is getting stronger and stronger. And in Islam, they're going to try to create something for us to react and make us look bad. We have to be wise how to deal with every situation. النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام when the Sahabi Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi came to Mecca and the people outside Mecca just at the gate of Mecca before you go inside they start warning him because he was a leader of what? Of Daws tribe in Yemen, big tribe in Daws, yeah? النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام the Kufar of Quraysh said to him there is a man inside be aware of him he said they scared me too much I got so scared I had to put a wool in my ears I don't want to listen to him. He said, I'm doing tawaf in the Kaaba because they were doing the tawaf before. Shirky way. He saw Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam praying. And he heard the Quran. He said, I liked it. Look. So Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is showing them the opposite. They described him as an evil man. He saw a man standing and reciting the Quran. He said, I heard the Quran. I said, woe to you, Amr. You're an Arab man. You know which one, what is poem, what is not a poem. He said, I removed it, I liked it. What he did, he followed Amr ibn Tafil ibn Tufail ibn Amr al-Dawsi. He followed him to his, Prophet ﷺ followed him. I mean, he followed Nabi ﷺ. Then he told him the story. Then he became what? A Muslim. So he gave him da'wah. The Kufa of Quraysh gave him da'wah. He was gonna about to come in and leave. They tried to scare him. Allah said, وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ Look to Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام when Umar said to him, let me kill the munafiq, the hypocrite. Look at Allahu Akbar, look at the wisdom of the Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام. He said, no Umar, don't do that. They are hypocrites, no doubt. But the people will say, Muhammad is telling anger his companions. So even this man is an evil man, he's causing evil, but by killing him, you're going to create a greater evil. But when you have ISIS and the foolish people, as the Nabi said, when he described them, حدثاء الأسنان, سفهاء الأحلام, young in age and foolish-minded, when you start going back to them, leaving the scholars, Sheikh Fawzan, Sheikh Albani, Sheikh Hussein Abbad, big scholars, and going back to young people, you see the calamity will happen. No hikmah. Like hyena, if I see on the street, I act like I say hyena, I have to cross the road. She'll bite me or something, you know? I have no respect for this woman. This woman, even non-Muslim man and woman, don't respect her. Wallahi. But we have to be careful. Barakallahu fikum.